Well, good morning, I should say. Good afternoon and good evening. Welcome to all of our attendees tuning in from around the world. Today's Zoomcast of Invisible Women in Sport is an Institute for Sport and Social Justice production. I'm your producer, Garnett Overby. All guests will be muted during this production, but I encourage you to use the chat feature to ask questions or leave a comment. We will reserve time near the end to answer a few questions. So now, without further ado, I would like to welcome our host, Tolu Lope Amakore.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. So, welcome to episode 9. Oh, my God. Episode 9 of Invisible Woman in Sports. I am your host, Tolu Lope Amakore. Today, I am joined by Coach Traci Green, head women's tennis coach at Harvard University. Welcome, Coach. Good to have you today.
Thank you for having me.
So, Coach Green, you're entering your 14th season after taking a program over on July 1st, 2007. Coach Green, you became the first African American coach at Harvard to win an Ivy League crown. Okay, that's very impressive. And you own a career coaching record of 140, the 110 at Harvard, and 174, the 100 to 138 overall. That's very impressive. So welcome, welcome, welcome. So let's get into some topics today. So let's talk about your early life. So who were some of your biggest influence? And that could be in sports in general.
Wow, if I were to go way, way back, you know, early life, I'm not that old, but I'm going way back here. I would have to see my parents. I had two parents at home, so I was very fortunate that way. And they really made sure me and my brother had everything we needed. And all my memories were just so great, you know, growing up. My dad could make a trip to the store, so exciting. And not to mention, I'd be able to go fishing with him and things like that. And I had an amazing mom who had one of those superhero type jobs. So all my memories were great growing up. And I'm very fortunate to have, you know, two parents still alive and still doing well.
Thank God, thank God. Speaking of your mother, with Tina Slow Green as your mother, can you think of some lessons that she taught you at a young age that you still go by to this day?
I would say the biggest thing is just the example that she was able to set. Again, I had two parents, you know, who were working and really doing the best they could every day. So that was a good visual for me. And then as far as she was concerned, just being able to see that person in her field. She did work in a predominantly, you know, white environment, you know, white spaces, and then see her produce, excel. That was a really good example for me. So it made me believe that I could do it.
Right.
Seeing her. So I say that was a big example for me without her really even saying anything about that. But that, again, that was something that I didn't really realize until later in life, but looking back, that was huge.
Okay, she's actually on today. Hi, Miss Tina, if you see us, yes, hello. So you were very beasty during your college years. You know, I'm gonna boost your head up right now as we talk. So as a college player at the University of Florida, you was a member of the Gators 1998 NCAA championship team and was ranked nationally as high as number 5 in doubles and number 12 in singles during the 99 and 2000 season. So with that saying, every student athlete has their favorite moments, games. What was your favorite athletic memory?
Ooh, so many, Tolu. We had amazing coaches there, great teammates, great sports environment. I have to say, I'd say two. Okay. Two is one, when you win a national championship, you get to go to the White House. So that was an amazing experience. So our whole team got to go on this private jet. And we, you know, we flew to DC, went all around different parts of DC. And at the time, Clinton was in the office and he couldn't make it. So his wife was there. She met us and gave us a tour. So that was a really cool moment. Another moment, I would say, beating Stanford. We lost to them in the finals of the NCAA. I think it was like, maybe it was like 97 or something. And then the following year, we beat them at this indoor tournament. I played amazing that day, so it's always in my mind.
We love to see it. You didn't tell me about the White House memory now. We spoke yesterday. You would tell me that. Come on.
Came to me. I had to bring it up.
That's amazing. So I remember my first tennis match at UCF. They was actually playing against UF. And first of all, I didn't know tennis was that long. I don't know how you do it, man. But how did you get ready for your matches?
That's another good question there. I would get in the zone. I was a zone type player. You know, people in the locker room who are loud, some people are quiet. I was one of those get in the zone type of players. So as soon as I walked in that door, I was ready. People knew, don't talk to me. I was in the zone. Usually we had music, you know, playing in our locker room, something like that. But that was what I did generally to get ready. I had a pattern. I had a routine. I was always ready to do business. So it's kind of how we do it even on my teams today. I want everybody to walk into the building ready to go.
Oh, yeah. I was never that quiet player. Yeah, I got in the zone, listened to some music. I was getting ready. So what did you actually, quick question now, I'm thinking about it. Was there any like pregame meals or anything that you had to eat before you went up?
So you know what, I was a cramper, so I didn't eat that much. I actually had to drink a lot of electrolytes. Ooh. If I didn't drink enough in Florida, I would just be cramping and within an hour. It was weird. So I would put out everything. But generally speaking, I would have to drink a whole, they called it Gator Load at the time. I don't know what it's called now, but I had to drink a whole can of Gator Load before I could do anything. That's my routine, generally.
No pickle juice? No Pedialyte? None of that?
Not at that time. We were sponsored by Gatorade because it was Florida Gators, right? So we had Gator Load, and it was like this nasty, like, caramel drink.
Ew!
Yes.
It worked,
though.
Ooh, I'm going to Google that after that because I'm not sure what that is. I'm not sure. So let's talk about your coaching career. At what moment did you decide to get into coaching?
So after college, I always sort of did coaching here and there. I would start hitting with players, usually younger players or adults. And then the hitting kind of progressed to teaching private lessons, and the private lessons progressed to coaching players who played tournaments. I even coached in schools. I worked with the foundation that I was a part of, called the Black Women in Sport Foundation. Woo-hoo. And there was a lot of I'd say underserved schools. So I got my feet wet in coaching in a big gymnasium with a bunch of kids. So I got all different types of experiences there after college. And then I made a lot of contacts, you know, through my junior playing days with folks in the USTA. So they, you know, brought me aboard to get all my certifications. So it was always like a part-time thing for me as I was, you know, doing graduate school and working a full-time job. And then eventually, you know, progressed to coaching in college.
That's amazing. So what is your favorite part of coaching?
My favorite part of coaching would be working with young people. That's what I do the most right now, is work with young people. Just really seeing their development, taking somebody when you see them at 16, mm-hmm. 17 years old, and you work with them all the way up. You're part of their development, that whole maturation process. And then they graduate, and you see them develop even more as life goes on. So it's really cool to be a part of their lives that way. And that's the cool thing about college coaching.
Oh, okay. So what are some coaching lessons that you always try to instill in your players?
So one of the things we focus on is controlling what we can control, especially right now during COVID-19. You know, we have players who are all over the world, literally. And we can't control whether we have a season or not. So just really being able to control the controllables. We work on improving nonstop every day. We try to improve as much as we can every single day. That's our goal, coming out of the blocks. And our attitude. So again, everything that we can control, that's our biggest mindset, theme for our team.
Hmm. So you was an assistant coach, back in Temple. What was the, I'm not gonna ask hardest thing, but how did you transition from being an assistant coach to a head coach? How was that transition?
So believe it or not, I initially took the assistant job as a GA or a graduate assistant type person. I was already in grad school at the time, and I knew the current assistant, he was graduating. He was like, yeah, you take my position. I was like, okay. And I was a volunteer coach. So I said, I'll see if I can do it. I had a full-time job. I had to see if my employers would make it work. And they did. They made it work for me. I was allowed to do it. So that was nice. And I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed that full-time coaching experience with our team and going on the trips and again, seeing the development. I did have to stop because I did end up at the time buying a home and getting a full-time job at the time. But then a year and a half or so passed and I realized I missed it. I really missed that that feeling of being on the tennis court as much as I was. And that kind of pushed me back in that direction.
Thank you for sharing. So as you know, you was a student athlete, I was a student athlete. We, you know, we deal with adversity and challenges. I know that I tore my ACL twice, two different knees, my left and my right. My right one, it was tough. I did that my junior year of my college season. And instead of just, you know, feeling sorry for myself and just sitting by the sideline, I'm like, what can I do with my time now? You know what I'm saying? So that time actually gave me, I actually started looking into grad school, into the DeVos program. What am I going to do after sports? So with that question, what were some challenges that you faced while growing up and in your career, in your coaching career?
I would say injuries also. I had not very many, but few that were pretty big in my mind that took me out for at least a month or two. And that's a lot of time in tennis, especially for developing or in the middle of a season. When I was growing up as a junior player, I sprained my ankle and I was playing the best tennis of my whole junior career. I was actually overseas in Belgium playing a tournament right before the French Open juniors. So yeah, I was playing really well, like I said, and I just rolled my ankle. I had to fly all the way back home and I was out for like 2 months. Hey. And that kind of made me, you know, pause and just really take inventory of everything. And in my life, I was, you know, still a teenager. So that was one time in my life that kind of gave me pause around injuries and kind of just weighing the balance of sports and life. But then again in school, in college, undergrad, I think it was my senior year and my sophomore year, I had some back injuries and that took me out for a while. And that really got me thinking more about what's next because I was really thinking pro. That's one of the reasons why I went to University of Florida because we had one of the best coaching staffs around and we were winning championships. That's what we did, right? People went pro from that program. And once I hurt my back, and I was out for a while, and I couldn't move at all. It was pretty bad. So that kind of made me pause and think about grad school, actually. I started studying for the GRE and just thinking way beyond the present.
Wow, that's amazing. So with your mom being the legendary Coach Tina Sloan Green, did you feel any pressure to follow your mother's footstep or to fulfill her expectations?
You know what? Not at all. And she, so growing up with a parent who was a coach, it was just so natural just to be around her coaching. I mean, she coached before I was alive and was also taught as a professor. And so all my memories are just of her doing her thing. It was like, had nothing to do with me, right? Because I was doing my thing. And in fact, I never even really played lacrosse because they didn't have it in my school at the time. And, I was from the city. So it was kind of had to be from the suburbs or like know of a club to belong to. So it would have been pretty hard for me to try to play lacrosse. And if I really wanted to, I did play field hockey briefly in middle school. But tennis was my thing. I picked it up probably around 10-ish and never looked back.
Who actually inspired you to get into tennis?
Actually is winning and getting a recommendation from a coach. So, hey, you should pick up a tennis, for Traci to pick up some lessons. And the coach told my mom, I was in a summer camp and the coach told my mom, she was like, Traci, tennis, you want to play this sport? And I'm like, okay, yeah, I'll get some lessons. And they were free at the time. And I was getting pretty good pretty quickly and beating the boys. So I was like, okay, I'll go to this center and that center and start playing more and more. And it was fun to win. So that kind of got me involved.
We love it. Keep beating the boys. We love to see it. So what's the hardest part of being a female head coach? Not even just a black female head coach at an Ivy League school.
I'd say, let me think about that, Pete. I think the hardest part about that, I'd say it can be pretty isolating at times because you are the only one. Just knowing that there really aren't any more coming after you that you can see immediately, that's pretty tough. So you have, in tennis, you have like the Power 5 level sports teams and you have the Ivies. We're kind of like that same level. And there really, really aren't any more Black females. So I really am the only one. So when you go recruiting and things like that, you always wonder, you know, how bad it would be to go recruiting or see other coaches look like you and
right.
able to, you know, bounce ideas off of, et cetera. But that doesn't happen. There are a few males, you know, doing great jobs, you know, where they are, but you really don't find them. You do find a few at the mid-major levels, but it's, the isolation is probably the trickiest thing about it. But obviously, you know, you learn to deal with it and you keep moving on from there.
Mm. So with everything going on now, Coach, and things like that, is there anything that your team is doing or, you know, you're trying to get into, anything new going on with you guys?
Our current team?
Yes.
So right now we're just getting ready to build for our season. So we're just trying to get in the mindset of, again, how we're going to be and face this new COVID reality as we come back to school. Some are going to be off campus, some are going to be on, you know, knock on wood, things keep moving forward. One of the things on campus that some of our players are involved in, that I've actually been involved in as well, has been being a part of our new Black student athlete group that's emerging on campus and seeing them, you know, mobilize and organize and really do some positive things. So again, it's still formulating and I'm excited about it.
Wow, that's amazing. So is there any last minute advice to everyone that's watching, whether that's in general or just in coaching or just anything? The floor is yours.
You know, I would say at this point, you know, the value of sports are just so immense. You know, I think when you see our young people, when they don't have sports, you just see the toll that it really takes on them. So I would say, you know, from the grassroots level all the way up to the pro level, we really have to support our local programs to make sure we still have sports for our young folks, particularly those folks who might not be as privileged, right? So you don't realize what you have until you don't have anymore. And we're all going crazy in our homes, et cetera, and you can't go to the gym, whatever. So again, I think just understand the value of sports and making sure that everybody has access to sports, because they play a big role in my life, and I think they can continue to play a huge role in others' lives as well.
Wow, thank you for sharing that, Coach. Before we go into Q&A, quick question. As a tennis player and a tennis coach, who is your favorite tennis player, whether that's female or male? Who'd you say?
Today, I have to go with the GOAT, Serena. You know, I got to go with Federer, Roger Federer. You know, he's doing his thing, injured right now, but he's doing his thing.
Okay.
Serena's playing Venus right now. I heard they split sets. That's what someone said. But, you know, I think those are probably my go-to tennis players at the pro level.
Okay, you said right now. Well, did you have anybody back in the day that you used to like?
Oh, I've had, you know, if you meant as a kid growing up, I used to like Steffi Graf. That was my favorite player growing up.
I gotta Google her too, because I'm not sure. All right, well, thank you for sharing. Now we're gonna go ahead and Garnett's gonna get some Q&A going.
Yes, Tracy, thank you so much. We have a question from Craig Thompson. He's one of our graduate assistants, and he's asking, throughout your career, both as a student athlete and a coach, how has your leadership traits developed? And what advice can you give to us that translates to our professional and personal life to influence and create change in our respective fields?
Yeah, that's a long one there. I think leadership traits wise, I think listening is really important. You know, learning how to listen and really hear what folks are telling you, what they're trying to tell you. You know, in my profession, we have, you know, kids who are, you know, still growing up and don't quite know how to tell you stuff. So even kind of like knowing how to find out what they're trying to tell you is important. And knowing your own leadership style is also, I think is important. You know, having the right staff around you and support systems for those that you're teaching. What was the other part of that question?
The other part of the question was, what advice can you give to us? And he's a young college student working on his master's degree. So he's asking, what advice can you give to us that translates to our professional and personal life to influence and create change in our respective fields?
I would say be action oriented as much as possible. I think we have a lot of meetings. And as much as we can take those meetings and create action out of those meetings, I think that we're off to the races. So right now I'm in my life, and I think I'm taking part of meetings, right? I'm involved in a lot of meetings, but I'm making sure those meetings are turned into action. So I think as you're in graduate school, as you're advancing in your career, you know, yes, be part of groups and things for your resume, but try to be part of things that actually create action.
Very good. Okay. Now I have a few questions from Mr. Matt Edelson. You're familiar with Matt. And Matt is asking, how has your coaching style changed over the years? And how has your focus shifted, if it's shifted at all?
I think it has changed. Before, I used to be into, you know, big goals and try to chase that big future goal, you know, down the road. And now I'm focused on more daily goals, that day-to-day improvement type of mindset. I really feel like that's been paying off. What else? I think we've also been focusing on input from our athletes as much as possible. For example, we'll have a team meeting, and I'll go, before I say anything, I'll go around and ask our team what they thought about the match. They know I'm gonna have an answer, of course, at some point. I go around and ask them what they think, and we have a rule: you can't say anything unless you A, really mean it, and you're saying something to push our team forward. Or else don't say anything at all. So they know they shouldn't just say, something that doesn't make any sense, or you're just trying to make somebody feel good. Just say what needs to be said right now, everybody, and then I'll speak. So we really take advantage of our meetings together, and they know that their time's not being wasted. And they know that everything we do from the very first moment we walk into practice until our match or whatever game, we mean business, and we're trying to improve and get to that next level.
Right.
Outstanding. Matt is also asking, do you find yourself still mentoring your former players as they move through their postgraduate years?
I do. That's funny. They keep in touch, and it's fun to see them, you know, on with their regular lives, and even the ones who are recent grads, you know, they're always keeping. I'm not a good social media person until recently. I just started, you know, I'm paranoid of social media, but I've been involved with that, and it's also been able, good way for me to stay in touch with them that way as well. But that's what it's all about, right? Keeping those relationships and just staying a part of their lives. So definitely, that's been fun.
Absolutely. This question comes from Erica Nelson. Erica's asking, what can athletic administrators do better to support their Black coaches at predominantly white institutions?
I'd say listening, again, I go back to listening, and A, providing a space for them to be able to express their concerns or suggestions. But they also have to be ready for those answers, you know, from those Black coaches. I know right now, like I said, at Harvard, we have this group that we're forming, this student athlete group, and I'm serving as one of the advisors. And we have a new AD that just came aboard, and she understands her role is to really listen to this group and communicate with them as much as she can, and just really be ready to hear those answers, you know, when she asks, you know, what's going on and what's next here. So I think that's a big part of it.
Okay. This question is coming from Shira Thornton, and I hope I'm saying your name correctly. Shira is asking, she's going a little personal on you now, what are some of the similarities between your coaching style and your mother's coaching style?
Ooh. Good one. Okay, yeah, I know Shira. Okay. Let me think about that. I would say, so we did coach, you know, I coach an individual sport and she does coach a team sport. That's a little bit different there, but similarity wise, I would say we have our own way of getting people going. You know, we're not, you know, the loudest people out there, you know, on the field or on the court. But we have our way of being serious, and you know when we need business. So I think that'd be the quickest thing for me to stay there. I think we both probably recognize talent when we see it. I think she did a great job of recruiting in her day, right? Building a team, building a program that won national championships, recruiting folks like your folks from your family, et cetera, to help that vision come into fruition. And for me personally, you know, we haven't won a national championship, but I feel like, you know, talent-wise, I think we try to do the best we can, and that's one of the things I try to emulate as well.
Wow.
Okay, outstanding. And it's pronounced Shira?
Yeah.
Okay, Shira, I apologize. It's Shira, it's not Shira.
Come on. Get her name right.
I'm trying. This question comes from Kristen Harris. Kristen is asking, how have you been able to successfully navigate the collegiate space as a Black female? And have you seen any movement from a diversity standpoint?
I think he went in and out. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and read that question for you.
She said,
Barnett, you went in and out. I'm going to go ahead and just take over real quick. She said, how have you been able to successfully navigate the collegiate space as a Black female? And have you seen any movement from a diversity standpoint in coaching?
So growing up, I did move around in a lot of, you know, predominantly white spaces. So I was used to navigating, you know, those white spaces, whether that be school, whether that be my immediate neighborhood. I did live in Philadelphia, which is very diverse city, but my immediate neighborhood was white. My school, my K through 12 school was white. My tennis team was white. So I was kind of used to navigating in that space. So, and as you go higher in tennis, there really aren't any folks who look like you. So that's, I think that's one of the ways you get familiar with that environment, navigation wise. I think support systems are huge. You know, having your own support system, you know, having allies out there along the way. I'm very fortunate that, you know, at Harvard we have, you know, several, you know, allies that have been, you know, in my corner all the way through. I don't think I'd be able to, you know, have the success that I've had without those folks. So that's important. What was the second part of the question?
And she said, have you seen any movement from a diversity standpoint in coaching?
Okay, in tennis specifically, I think, is that what she means in general? Maybe. Tennis, it's tough because it's all about who's coming up below,
right?
You know, the players. So I think you're seeing more players, you know, after, you know, Venus. I didn't grow up with Venus and Serena. Like, they were a little bit younger than me, but, you know, I think a lot of young players stopped playing. You know, a lot of Black players for whatever reason. I was on a call the other day, a Zoom call with some coaches, some Black coaches, and they were saying how a lot of the expectations put on them from, you know, white coaches, from folks, you know, they really kind of discouraged them from going too far in tennis, or kind of limiting them, or maybe they don't have the resources to keep playing, et cetera. So the numbers you don't see so strong at the highest levels. So those top jobs, you know, are really scarce. And just the other day, there's a job at, I don't know if I can say that over Zoom, but there's a job at, some school, I would say, Big Ten, an assistant coach job, and they called me, like, who's out here? They really want to look for, you know, a Black female as an assistant. I can only think of one person who played at a high level.
Wow.
At one of those currently at a, you know, or was sort of on the path to a Power Five type of school. So there really aren't, the numbers really aren't there. So have I seen a diversity in tennis? Not so much. You know, let's hope we see more. Hiring is a huge part of it. You have to really want to increase diversity at your school. So I think all the sports, you have to really want to. If you're at a predominantly white institution, you have to really, you know, want to make that move. I hear different companies are creating like the new Rooney Rule or whatever. You got to really want to make that change and create policies that promote those changes.
Okay, so Garnett had some audio difficulties, so I do apologize about that. So I'll be taking over. I know you guys, but thank you. All right, so we got two more questions before we wrap it up for you. So Debbie Goldfein, she asked, what advice would you give young people who aspire to be coaches? Is a two-part question, that's first one. And the second question is, how did you build your network?
Great questions. Number one, I'd say have thick skin. Because coaching in college, every day is a new day, Tolu. Again, you're dealing with young people, and it really is, you know, how they will, you know, wake up, come out of bed, you know, every day. So really just understanding, you know, who you are, what you're all about, and again, having thick skin, you know, having a coaching philosophy, standing for something, right? So you don't just change with the wind as they change every day. Mm-hmm. And understanding your role, you know, what you're there to do. And they're going to be ups, they're going to be downs.
Right.
Time like this, where you don't even know, you know, what's going on one day to the next, right? Mm-hmm. So that's important in that way. What was the second part of the question again?
How did you build your network?
Right. Good question. I think I was fortunate going back to, again, I was fortunate with my parents. You know, they always, you know, had me moving in different circles. As a youngster, you know, my mom was a coach, and she'd go to several conferences, and she also was a professor. I remember, you know, listening to Dr. Lapchick when I was probably, you know, 10 or 12 at some conference, and my report cards and different things. So I think my, just looking back, I remember just, I had a pretty big, or pretty, I'm very fortunate to have those experiences. Very, very blessed as well. I mean, I look back and I, now at 10 years old, who knows the difference between, who knows what tenure means when you're 10, right? Who knows what sabbatical means? I can ask my team now, what's sabbatical? And half of them wouldn't even know but I probably knew that when I was very young, being around the college campus. So that's probably one way. And again, my parents always kind of gave me the idea that you have to have a support system and a network. So I kind of saw that happening. So I tried to keep building that as I went.
Thank you for sharing. We got one more question from my fave, Dr. Manoj Chopra. So another two-part question. Is it easier or harder to coach in a high academic environment like Harvard and Ivy Leagues? And what are some of the challenges?
It's a good question. I would say it's harder. I think we're competing for their attention. Generally speaking, at some of these high academic institutions, yes, you can get some of the best recruits because they're putting all the time into their sport. But once they get there, you really have to hold their attention to a certain degree. So in other words, they have these academic demands on them. You know, they have social demands. Same thing at other institutions. But particularly when you don't have scholarships, you really got to make sure they get their time. They get to put their time in with those other demands and actually live a balanced life. So coaching style and a program culture that allows them to have that balance, but still, you know, try to achieve in your sport and obviously win at the same time. That's one of the toughest parts these days.
Okay. I think Dr. Manoj, did she answer it? Yep, he's thumbs up. Okay, so someone just asked me one more question. I'm sorry, you're popping it down. I'm just so sorry. This is from David Williams. Describe some of the ways you help players improve their mental toughness on the court. Go.
So it sounds a little bit, first of all, I'm a pretty focused person. Our team knows I'm either very focused or I'm very laid back. I have no middle. When I'm coaching usually. So, you know, coach is relaxed. He's joking around. Our coach is very serious. So I have no middle. So they know I either mean business or I'm relaxed. So that's one of the ways I kind of get them, you know, keep them focused right away. Mm-hmm. I'm also fortunate enough to have help. So what does that mean? I try to have outside people talk to them as well. So they have different voices in their head. What does that mean? That means, you know, I might reach out to, if we can, we have like a sports psychologist that helps them. I tell them to, or ask them to try to, you know, add something else into their lives, maybe like yoga, something. So I try to get them thinking a little bit outside of the box. But I think it starts with me, just making sure they know that I'm on their side. And even when I'm relaxed, I'm on your side. Even when I'm tough, you know, I'm on your side. So I think the other part of it, I think we have to also recruit toughness. Times it can be hard to learn, you know, mental toughness completely, I think, in college. You can get better, but it's hard to, like, create that out of nowhere.
Yeah, that's true.
So I think it's our job as coaches to try to seek those folks who have those building blocks or have that foundation of mental toughness when they come to school.
Wow. Thank you so much for your wisdom, Coach. I really do appreciate it. And I hope everyone enjoyed this episode. Thank you so, so much.
Thank you for having me.
All right. So everyone on here, tune in on September 3rd at 2 p.m. for episode 10. Yes, I said it. Episode 10 already. I know. I'll be speaking with Darice Griffin, Deputy Director of Administration at the University of Georgia. So after this episode, we'll go ahead and post it on our social media. So don't forget, put it on your calendar. Also, we thank you for all of your support of Invisible Women in Sports. We are a nonprofit organization with other programs that impact various social justice issues. With that saying, please use the QR code to support us with a financial gift as we continue to change lives through the power of sport. Thank you. So go ahead, whip out that phone. Go ahead, QR code. Click, click. Yep. Mm-hmm. And the credits again, I am your host, Tolulapa Mokora. Today's special guest, Coach Traci Green. Our producer, Garnett L. Overby, the third. Our advising consultants, we have Matt Edelson, Spencer Barnes, and Craig Thompson's. We couldn't do it without you. Again, special thanks to all the organizations that registered today. Special thanks. Mwah, mwah. We love you. Again, please follow us on all social media platforms to stay up to date and informed on future programs. We're on YouTube, we're on iTunes, we're on Google Play, we're on Facebook, we're on Twitter, we're on Instagram, we're not on Snapchat, so don't look at us on Snapchat, and we're on LinkedIn. So go ahead and follow us. Follow us. Again, mark it on your calendar. We have Darice Griffin, September 3rd at 2 p.m., episode 10. Invisible Woman in Sports Zoomcast. See us now. Bye, everyone. Mwah. Mwah. Mwah.